It looks like we're loving Luke this week, isn't it? Luke chapter 1. I was thinking just not so long ago, when I was at school and I used to use what a lot of people, some people don't even know what it is. Have you got the shot of it? Put that thing up there. This is what I used to count with when I was at school. It's called, what's it called? There you go. There's some older people in there. And so I was thinking about this little thing, you know, we used to use, and you know, I'm thinking, I'm at school, I work in the school with the kids, and they take out calculators. This is a scientific calculator. So get the abacus out, put that away, you don't need that. But what it led me to think is that all through life, you know, the abacus to the calculator, the chariot to the Lexus, you know, clocks, radios, mobile phones, the internet. When I got saved, we had no internet. Everything that man has created and changed and developed over time has just been developing. And the thought that captures me here is that no matter how many thousands of years have passed, prayer has remained the same. Still got to bow your knee. Still got to find a quiet place. Still got to raise your hands to God. There is no electronic prayer as such. Prayer has to come from the human heart. Genesis chapter 4, 26 says, and to Seth, to him also was born a son, and his name was Enos. Then began men to call upon the name of the Lord. The same is true today. I want to speak about prayers in the last day today. Luke chapter 1. I'm going to read a few more verses. I'm going to read from verse 5. It said, there was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias of the course of Abia. And his wife was of the daughters of Aaron. Her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blameless. And they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren. And they both now were well stricken in years. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course. According to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord, and the whole multitude of the people were praying without the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. When Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. And the angel said unto him, fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard. And thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. I want to say today that prayer is supernatural. And a lot of times we just think that when we pray, I've just said a prayer, God answered this prayer, and we just move on. But prayer is supernatural. And what the altar of incense is all about is that part of the little bit of furniture that they have. And they put coals in there, and then they put the incense on top. And what it gives a picture of our prayers, you know, rising and ascending up to God. And so this was Zechariah's job. So the Bible says Zacharias was righteous, kept the commandments, all the ordinances, and he was blameless before God. You can imagine after so many years, the Bible says he was stricken. He was way down the road in age. And you can imagine after praying for so many years, watching the altar of incense from afar, because he didn't do it all the time. They were chosen by lot. And it just happened to be his time. So he's standing there looking at the incense rising up, rising in the temple. And he's looking at that. And he's probably prayed for 3-4 decades the same prayer. Never heard anything happen. No change in his wife. And the angel comes to him and says, your prayer is heard. Because prayers are far-reaching. In other words, it doesn't matter how many years go past, your prayer still exists in the mind of God. Our prayers don't have no sell-by date. We think after a period of time, you know, prayers is going to go away. but they have no sell-by date. What I mean by that is, no matter how many years pass after you prayed, God can still answer that. And here is Zacharias, he's standing in the temple. You have the veil in front of him that hides the holies of holies. You have the altar of incense in front of that veil, and all the incense is going up. And he's prayed time and time again. No answer. Our prayers reach right down into the future, some of them. And we have no idea when they're going to be answered, how they're going to be answered, and how it's going to affect you. Our nation is bathed in prayer. Bathed in prayer. There was a hitchhiker that was traveling in America, and he, you know, stuck his thumb out, and the driver pulls over and he jumps in. There's a businessman. So he gets into this man's car, they're driving along, and they're talking, having a great chat. After a couple of hours, this hitchhiker is about to get out, and the driver says, the businessman says, "Hey, here's my card. Take my card, and you know, when you're next in town, when you're coming back through, you can contact me, and you know, we can drink some, let's say coffee, because they're not English. We're going to have a cup of coffee together." So anyway, he goes on about his business, and about 3 or 4 weeks later, he's on his way back, and he goes, "You know, I'm going to visit this guy. So he goes to the house, he knocks on the door, and this woman opens the door. Her eyes are bloodshot red, and she's standing, looks at the guy, and she goes, "You know, what you want?" sort of thing. He goes, "I've come to see, you know, blah, 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 you know." And she goes, "Well, my husband's dead. He died about 4 weeks ago in a car crash." And she goes, "You know what? I prayed to God for so many years for my husband, and he never answered me." And she at that time was battling with God in prayer and saying, why? So the hitchhiker turns around and says, "Listen." He goes, "I had a conversation with your husband. I'm a Christian. And in those 4 hours I was with him, I led him to Jesus. You and I don't know about our prayers." Exodus 30 verse 8, it says, "When Aaron lights up the lamps at evening, he shall burn incense upon it, a perpetual incense before the Lord throughout all generations," meaning that prayer is meant to be constant. It's not meant to stop. But F.B. Meyer says, "The greatest tragedy of life is not unanswered prayer, but prayer that is unoffered." What does Paul say? Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, he says, "Pray without ceasing." He says, "Make that your lifestyle, make it what you're about." Isn't it funny? We have an argument in our relationship, wife or husband, and we stop praying. What's Jesus got to do with your argument? You know, "I have an argument with this person, I have an argument," and then we stop talking to God. Can someone say amen? We can even take it further. Don't come miss a service. Why don't you want to come and listen to God? Paul is saying, despite what you're going through, despite what you feel, despite what's happening around you, he says, pray without ceasing. Jesus himself said in Luke 18:1, he spake a parable unto them, the Bible says, "To this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint." Don't grow weary when it comes to prayer. Don't back out. Don't think, you know, "Oh, it's not worth it. I might as well do something else." No, you continue to pray. Because sometimes you've got to fight in prayer. It's quite funny. Pastor Brian spoke to me not too long ago and was speaking about, you know, praying out. And, you know, as a church, the hum of wolf and stuff, you know, just praying. And I didn't tell him, but, I God convicted me before. And like, it says, we don't want our prayer meetings to be like a Charlie Chaplin movie, where you can see all the hands waving, you can see all the lips moving, but we can't hear nothing. When since did our prayer meetings become quiet? When since did they become silent? That we don't want anyone to hear what we're talking about. You have to make people hear what you're talking about, because we need to encourage those that are coming behind us. We have to help those that don't know how to pray. We don't need Charlie Chaplin movies in our prayer meetings. Can someone say amen? You know, if we look a bit closer, because there's warfare in our prayer too, because Ephesians 6:18 says, praying always with all prayer and supplications in the Spirit, watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplications for all saints. And Paul is saying, you know, there's going to come a time of warfare when you pray. A time when you have to say, you know what, I'm going to have to stay up a couple more hours, so I'm going to have to pray through something. A time when you receive opposition in the streets, so sometimes you need to take time to pray. Because we can be a little bit naive sometimes when the authorities come and you want to turn up the PA instead of turning it down and listening to them and get in the corner and pray. Nah, man, we're the potter's house, turn it up. You're going to be potter's nothing. When the council says, we don't want your church to do things. But we have a little bit of wisdom and pray for and say, you know what? Let me pray for the council. You know, when I was in Harrow one time, I remember some councilwoman came against us. It was like the Job time. She comes and then a couple of homosexuals came. Then some old guy came and everyone shouted at him, thinking, what's going on here? I had to go and pray. And the next few weeks later, a policeman came up to me. He goes, are you the pastor? I said, yeah. I'm thinking, oh no, we've done that. He goes, listen. He goes, when you're doing your stuff, if you get any problems from anybody, you come to me. I said, wow. Forget all this, turn it up with the potter's house. We've got the authority on our side. And we use that to our advantage. Prayer is everywhere in our society, all over the place. And God is always looking to help us. 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in behalf of those whose heart is perfect towards him. Hearing thou hast done foolishly, it goes and speaks about the king. But the part we need to look at, he's looking for somebody to help. When you don't pray, what message are you sending out? I remember many years ago living in Northampton, and there's a couple that live next door to us called Jeff and Debbie. They're quite affluent people. And so they had this massive cottage with six bedrooms. And you know, I never really go there much because like Lorne went there with Ella Rose. She's a little kid and the woman had a little baby, so they all played together. So I think Lorne said, yeah, there's a plaque in this bedroom. I think it's got like some kind of preacher on there. I said, is it? So I went in there, went into this little room. It was all peaceful in there. I looked on the wall and it was John Wesley's prayer room. And I stood in that room and I must admit, I said a little prayer when I was there. So I can say to you, like, you know what? I prayed with John Wesley prayed. Get some anointing, get something happening. But it was really powerful because sometimes we don't really enter in and find out what prayer is doing in our nation. We may speak about it. We may talk about it. But one of the greatest miracles is the Salvation Army. And I'm not the sort of person, oh, the baptism, I don't do that. Because somewhere in history you'll find these people did some wonderful and great things for God. And so the Salvation Army, in 1913, they opened this hospital in Lower Clapton in Hackney. And this hospital was created for, prostitutes that had babies, all the single mothers, people that wasn't, all this sort of stuff, all these sort of women that were rejected. The reason why is because in those days, the maternity hospitals would only admit women that were married. And so what happened, they made this hospital, they bought 2.7 acres of land, built this great hospital, and every baby that was born there had hands laid on them and prayed over. This young Jamaican West Indian girl had a baby in that hospital, me. And then 2 years later, Eric Roberts was born there. I don't know what they prayed over me, but prayer is far reaching. And all these years later, I'm preaching. Can you say amen? Prayer prayer, it's a miracle. And the reason why I say it is because sometimes we feel guilty in our own prayer life, especially when someone gets sick. And we begin to run around like it's the first time we prayed for them. But God gave me a revelation. He says, Harry, your prayer is far-reaching. I used to pray this prayer. If I can't get my parents saved through my own witness, I said, can you send a faithful Christian to reach them? So what happened when my dad was in hospital when he was dying, I went there and I was in the corridor and this girl's waving at me. I think, who's that? You know, I'm just waving anybody. So I'm standing with my sister, so I kind of like wave back. So she comes walking to me and it's Janine. She's from the Wolfenstow Church. So she says to me, she goes, what are you doing there? I said, well, just here for my dad. And so I point to him and she goes, oh, I've been praying with him for the past few days. I've been helping him. And my sister's looking, I'm thinking, this is incredible. But what's even more powerful is that even though she's there working, she said she was transferred there. So here is this young lady, works in a hospital, COVID is going crazy, it's all mad. God, before I even knew anything, moves her from a hospital to another hospital, to my dad's ward, and she's actually helping him. That is powerful. Where your prayers can go before you, when you have no idea what God is doing, because your prayers don't have a sell-by date. A supernatural God who uses our prayers when he wants to bring about his purpose. I want to talk to you about our prayers in heaven. Because we're not in Israel. We don't have an altar of incense and we don't see all the incense rising up to the heavens. And we don't see none of that. We just pray. So I thought I'd give you a little glimpse of what God really feels about us and our prayers. Let's turn to Revelation chapter 8, verse 1 today. Revelation 8 and verse 1. It says, and when he opened the seventh seal, speaking about Jesus, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. I have never read heaven being silent, ever. It says, silence in heaven. There's no angels singing. There is no thunder. There's no lightning. There's no harps being plucked. There is total silence in heaven. And then verse 2 says, and I saw the seven angels that stood before God, and to them was given seven trumpets. We know judgment is coming. And so there's silence. Then you see these seven angels walk forward. They've got their trumpets. They're probably wetting their lips and getting ready. And you think, oh no, for the human race. But then this happens. Another angel, verse 3, came and stood at the altar. What altar? The altar of incense that is in heaven. Having a golden censer, there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of the saints upon the golden altar that was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense which came up with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. When Zacharias was on earth and he was doing that, the same thing was happening in heaven. Can someone say amen? And so here is God. You know, heaven is silent. The angels are getting ready. And then the Bible says another angel comes and begins to offer up the incense with the prayers of the saints. God is about to bring judgment on the world. And God has made, no, God is not going to stop judgment for anything else than this. I'm going to judge the world. I'm going to do things. Things are going to happen. It's going to be mayhem everywhere. But God said, hold on. I want total silence. Why does God want total silence? He says the prayers of the saints are going before God. What's happening? It's almost like God is saying, he's saying, let me hear the prayers of the brokenhearted. Let me hear the prayers of married couples. Let me hear the prayers of the struggling pioneer pastors. Let me hear the prayers of the single mothers. Let me hear the prayers of the widows and the fatherless. Let me hear the prayers of the sinner. This is the God we serve. What did the psalmist say? He says in verse 2 of 141, it says, let my prayer be set forth before thee as an incense, and the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice. Psalm 34:15 says, the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous. His ears are open unto their cry. This is the God we serve, a God that says, you know what? If you lift your voice for me, no matter about your circumstance, no matter where you're at, I'm going to listen to what you have to say. Not only does God listen to our prayers, church, he answers them by fire. Revelation 8:5, it says, this is after the prayers of the saints have gone up. It says, and the angel took the censer, filled it with fire of the altar, and cast it down to the earth. We're praying, God is answering. 1 Kings 18:37, it says, hear me, O Lord, hear me, that these people may know that thou art the Lord God, and thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stone and the dust and licked up all the water that was in the trench. God answers by fire. 1 Chronicles 21:26, it says, and David built there an altar unto the Lord and burnt offerings and peace offerings and called unto the Lord, and he answered him from heaven by fire upon the altar of the burnt offering. This is amazing. God still answers by fire. Romans 12 verse 1 says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And in Acts 2:4 says, tongues of fire sat upon them. So you're living sacrifices. Everyone's looking at me. We're living sacrifices. And what we need to be praying is that God will put his fire on us. I don't just want to read about a dead sacrifice and a fire coming down from heaven. I want to read in our time and listen to people testify of the fire of God coming upon their lives, breakthrough, all sorts of revival happening. Why? Because our God answers by fire. From the altar of incense. There are people here this morning, delegates, disciples, young pastors, older pastors. And they have this question and they say, should I stay or should I go? Should I stay or should I go? Let me help you to go. Matthew 26, verse 29. As everyone knows, you know, we're going to be going to Jamaica at some point. But the full story is that I asked about 17 years ago, 2003. I remember, Pastor Man probably don't remember, I was driving him to Gatwick and we missed a turn off and all sorts of things, just chatting. Just, oh no, the airport, is that what? You know, so we're talking and I kind of mentioned that and just kind of looked. He goes, not now. He didn't say no, but I prayed. But when it comes to should I stay or should I go, there is a battle that's going to go in your heart. If you're really serious about what you want to do, if you're really serious about being a pioneer or being a missionary, you're going to have to go the way Jesus went. You see, we're so clever. We think we can circumvent everything. Just get round things and here I am. It doesn't work like that. Matthew 26 and verse 39. And he went a little further and fell in his face and prayed, saying, oh my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Some of you are dreaming about the day you stand on the stage. What a great day that will be. There are others, they want the joy that was set before them like Jesus had. But they don't want Gethsemane. See, the whole prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane is about the laying down of your will. You have to lay down your will and let God's will become your will. You're not going to do it on your own. You're not going to do it in your way. That's why Jesus had that Gethsemane. Lots of us have Gethsemanes. You know something? Some people won't pray the prayer of Gethsemane. You know why? Because they know there's a city or a nation waiting for them afterwards. Once you've made that prayer commitment, you begin to pray to God and say, God, you know, let your will be mine. You know, let it be me. Once you do that, because God's not going to say, He's going to hold you to your word. And when you come through the other side of Gethsemane, that's when things begin to happen. See, Gethsemane is about the laying down of the will. Giving up the familiar for the unfamiliar. Giving up the known for the unknown. Giving up family members for complete strangers. Giving up your dreams and your desires for the will of God. You're here this morning. You say, I want to go. I want to do so. Do you? Can you see the Macedonian man calling for help? Because I can. Can you hear the brokenhearted, lost? Because I can. Can you see the fatherless and the widow struggling? Because I can. This is what it feels like, the other side of Gethsemane. That, you know, no matter where it is, no matter what I have to do, I'm going to be going. See, God's heart is for the nations. And this is why Jesus was so vexed. In Mark chapter 11, verse 17, it says, and he taught, saying unto them, is it not written, my house shall be called of all nations the house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves. Here is Jesus. He comes into the temple and he can see, you know, all the tables of the money. You can see oxen and sheep. He's saying, what's going on here? The reason why he's so vexed is this was called the court of the Gentiles. This is the only place that Gentiles could come and pray to God. And as a matter of fact, it's where the Ethiopian eunuch was coming back from. He went to Jerusalem from Ethiopia and went to the court of the Gentiles and began to pray. And God must have said, where is he going? We need to find somebody to catch him before he gets back to Ethiopia. That's where Philip comes in the scene and begins to minister to him. This is so powerful. God wants every nation reached. He wants every person to be touched. He wants every nation to come into his kingdom. Isaiah 56:7. In fact, Jesus is caught in Isaiah and is caught in Jeremiah as well. The two texts have been put together. But it says, my house should be called a house of prayer for all people. The court of the Gentiles reserved for the people from all over the world to come and worship God. That's why Jesus is so mad. There's another scripture that I used to read. I think, oh, this is all nice and cuddly. This is like a nice, like Jesus, this, you know, it's lovely. And so it's Matthew chapter 9 and verse 37. It says, then saith him unto his disciples, the harvest is truly plenteous, but the laborers are few. You know, the Bible said he had compassion. He saw all the people. He just had compassion. And you read it, and I said, oh, Jesus had compassion. It's just, oh, it's nice, isn't it? Then he speaks to his disciples. In verse 38, he says, pray ye, therefore, the Lord of the harvest, that he will send out laborers unto the harvest. Really, oh, that's great. But you know what Jesus is saying? He said, you know what? You've not been here too long. He's saying, cast them out. Igbolo sounds like African, sounds like Nigerian. But Igbolo means to cast out. It's the same word Jesus, the Bible uses to say when Jesus cast out a demon. Basically he's saying, there's some people there, you lot need to get cast out. You need to get cast out. Wait, what are you still doing here? Why are you here? You know, the word actually means in Greek, It means to drive them out. Drive them out. You know why? Because there's people that act like they're not called and they are. Yeah, well, about 2 years. 2 years for what? You can build a church in 2 years. I mean, how much proof do you need? Oh, no. You know why people do Gethsemane? It challenges those that are afraid of failure. You won't pray that prayer because you're afraid of failing. How much proof do you need that God's going to help you? I mean, we read in Mark chapter 16, verse 14, Jesus comes in and it says, afterwards he appeared unto the 11 as they sat eating food, and he upbraided them with their unbelief and heart. He comes in and what are you doing here eating rice and peas? You're supposed to cast out demons. What are you doing here? Why are you still here? Why are you still here? You're supposed to be casting out demons and preaching to the world. You're sitting and yamming food. Why are you here? How much proof do we need that it can work? Jesus' sacrifice, resurrection, the disciples, Paul the apostle, Pastor Mitchell and his life and what he did. All the ministers, you know, you've got 2,700 odd people living for God and building churches, you're scared. You know, a vital part of our prayer life is to have a place in our heart and our schedule for the sending out of laborers into the harvest field. I remember Pastor Mitchell, his sermon, 2009, when Pastor Mitchell is dead, and he was speaking to his son, Greg, Pastor Greg, about the fellowship and the rebellions and different things like that. And he said in 1990s when it happened, the fellowship lost about 80 churches. There was like 580 churches left. This is in 1990. So when he was speaking in 2009, the fellowship had about 1,600 odd churches. That's an increase of about 1,100, say, in 19 years. But when I was listening to the sermon again in 2020, the fellowship is now 2780, which is another increase of 1,100, but in less time. So what's going to happen to us in the next 4 or 5 years? Is it somehow we're going to have another 1,100 churches? Prayer is at the heart of all of this. Because God, here's God, let's think about this. God in his purposes. Remember, your prayers have no sell-by date. And you pray something, and he gets that prayer. He says, you know what? I'm going to answer that over here. I'm going to answer that at this time here. So more people praying, more people involved, more people witnessing and getting involved with all that God is doing. Imagine the impact that's going to happen. Pastor Mitchell goes right back to the beginning. Right back to the beginning. As he begins to remember what it was like from in the beginning. Like I remember what it was like for me in the beginning. Not really knowing much, not really knowing where to go. You know, it was difficult. Impact team went like 3 months for one. Equipment, it's like, you know, you turn the volume up and everything goes up. Those were the days. But you know what? These are the days. These are the days. I'm living today. I'm back there. I'm here. And Pastor Mitchell remembers what it was like struggling. He said no one really cared about him and his wife. Nobody really bothered about them. There was a couple doing their thing. Little church in the corner. And he said this, it always stuck with me. As he begins to speak about his struggle, he says, you know what? He says, that's why I have a heart for the struggling pioneer pastor. So you don't think if you go out that your struggle is going to be frowned upon. they're going to be looking at, what's with this guy? What's going on there? Every single one of us have to come on the anvil of life. If God begins to build us and shape us, making mistakes, setbacks, disappointments, all the things that we go through. God is good in all those things. But I'm telling you, your prayer life is what's going to make all of the difference. How you pray, when you pray. Don't take prayer for a joke. This is a serious thing. And I remember times of prayer and thinking, how is this going to change? What's God doing? I'll let you in on a secret. When I used to go to my, still do now, but when I used to have my really difficult moments, I'd have to jump down to Hyde Park and go in the middle of nowhere in Hyde Park, go into the center there and start shouting. I wasn't shouting, shout to the Lord, all the earth. I was shouting to God. Not in rebellion, I just wanted to make myself known. I wanted no distractions. I wanted no hindrances. I just wanted to pray out to God as loud as I could. Sometimes you got to do that. Sometimes when you're battling your own personal life, you have to find a place. Jesus has a closet, but my closet was Hyde Park. I had a big closet. But wherever it is for you, that's where you have to go. And if it's Gethsemane, then go through Gethsemane, because you're never going to know. There is no cross without Gethsemane. And there is no joy beyond with no cross. You like, Pastor, man, Pastor, you just drive, you get my nerves, man. Listen, when your wife gets you enough, just do this. Sometimes you got to die on the cross. That's what Paul said. He said, just like, you know, Jesus died for us, we got to, some of you got to die on the cross at home, you just got to. Because you don't have to respond to everything. You don't have to try and be in control of everything. Sometimes you have to die. And sometimes, if the wife is like the church, because we let her for God, you know. So the wife now, she will come back to you later. When she sees you on the cross dying, she'll go, oh, I'm really sorry. So you have to die. Can you say amen? So in prayer, there are certain things that have to die. I don't like the way that people talk to me. It's too bad. You have to die. I love Zacharias. I know he got himself in trouble and God made him dumb, but I just like the way that he continued to do all that he was supposed to do despite the fact he didn't have what he wanted. And some of the times you have to, you know, you have to just go through things. You just have to go through things. You just have to, like, I've just got to go through it. And what do? Have vision. What is it God wants me to do? Where am I going? Where am I heading? And all these things are going through. You just look here. Like you tell your child when they're walking towards you, just look at me, and they kind of, and then they get to you because they're focused on you. People, we've got to be focused on Jesus. Our prayers in heaven are being answered. Our nation it's been absolutely saturated by prayer, which means there's got to be a harvest here somewhere. There has to be. Do you want that harvest? Do you want God to help you? Do you want all that God's got for you? Because prayer never changes, and your prayers don't have no sell-by date. Amen. Thank you. That's what I have for you.